been a soldier for a thousand years. He's a Catholic, a Hindu, an atheist, a Jain, a Buddhist and a Baptist and a Jew. And he knows he shouldn't kill, and he knows he always will kill you for me, my friend, and me for you. And he's fighting for Canada, he's fighting for France, he's fighting for the USA. And he's fighting for the Russians, and he's fighting for Japan, and he thinks we'll put an end to war this way. And he's fighting for democracy. He's fighting.
Well, you may have noticed that he keeps coming back. And, you know, things are just always strange. All one has to do is have a decent computer and then go online, and then you can find all kinds of interesting things that confirm that the Cheshire Cat really had a lot to say. I mean, I know many of you in high school may have read George Orwell, who in 1984 has this famous statement in which one of the characters says, "War is peace, freedom is slavery, ignorance is strength." And many of us think, well, this is all sort of hyperbole, exaggeration. But actually, when you begin looking carefully, you can see that George Orwell, far from being some sort of symbolist writer, was actually a stolid realist and was just describing reality. Because just a few days ago, we had this statement from Secretary of Defense Robert Gates. It says, the Obama administration accused Europe's leaders of endangering peace. Why? Not the way they endangered peace in the 1930s and 40s and 1914, but no, because of their growing pacifism. Very interesting. And reluctant to foot the bill for adequate defense. So, once again, we see that the Cheshire Cat always has a lot to say. It's a very good idea to pay attention to this, because as we saw last time, starting to talk about Afghanistan, this is not a joke. As of today, over 1,000 U.S. soldiers have been killed, and as we saw last time, because of our participation and the Soviets' participation and the general chaos and mess of the 1980s, over 1 million Afghans were killed, probably. That's a guess. We don't really know, but it's a reasonable estimate. 5.5 million had to flee their homes outside of the country. Many more were dislocated inside the country. Now, Afghanistan is famously known as the place where empires go to die. We looked at the British and the Soviets, and today we're going to look at our own further role, starting in the 1990s. We also saw that, once again, the great William Faulkner knew exactly what he was talking about. The past is not dead. It is not even past. We see this over and over and over again, which is why it is so important to pay attention to history. Because if one doesn't, and one then thinks, oh, well, we walk in and there's a blank slate, we can just do anything we want, we've already seen the kinds of consequences that that leads to in a place like Afghanistan, and we'll see exactly the same kind of thing happen in the country of Iraq, where we turn to either later today or beginning on Tuesday. We also saw that there are some structural features of Afghanistan that make it the way it is. Everything is produced. Nothing falls from the sky. Everything is caused. There are causes that then have further consequences, which in turn become causes, and so forth. A very rugged, very mountainous, very poor place that is landlocked, with a social system of intense local loyalties and necessarily a very weak central state, if indeed there's a central state at all. We know that there's a recurring theme, however, because outsiders repeatedly have intervened in this country. States collapse, there's an explosion, outsiders are tempted to intervene, even invade. The British did this, the Soviets did this. And what happens? They find the country inhospitable and ungovernable.
Finally, they withdraw, and internal conflict escalates until some new group establishes some semblance of order, which often offends external actors, and on and on and on it cranks. In terms of understanding the roots, we went all the way back looking at it on Tuesday, but more immediately, the roots of what we're going to talk about today were shown in this slide about the fostering of jihad by the United States, the Pakistani intelligence services, and the American government. And we saw that with the final collapse of the Soviet Union, there then ensued an internecine war for power among many actors, but the three big ones were a Tajik, Masoud, an Uzbek, Dostum, and a Pushtun, Hikmatyar. There was no political resolution, there was only carnage. The city of Kabul was effectively destroyed. And as a result of all of this, there emerged a culture of war. Now, one thing you want to think about in thinking about Afghanistan today in 2010, remember, if you're an Afghan and you are under the age of 30, you have never known anything except constant war, because after all, the Soviets invaded in 1979. So ever since then, there has been a state of constant war, and this too, of course, has consequences when we think, as usual, this is an overwhelmingly young society. So this whole generation growing up in this way, educated in, to the extent that we can call it education, in these madrasas, staffed by Deobandi ulama from India and Pakistan in particular, life was not good. There was anarchy. One must understand this if you want to understand the rise of a social movement called the Taliban. Taliban is originally an Arab word. All it means is students. The Taliban is a movement of students in these madrasas. Where did they come from? They first appeared in 1994. Remember, Soviet Union falls apart in 1991. 1992, the city of Kabul is sacked. Anarchy reigns, particularly in the southern Pushtun areas. Increasingly, they grew up local leaders. Remember, the older traditional leaders had already been destroyed, in effect, by Soviet counterinsurgency tactics, by flight, by bombing, etc. And so increasingly you got poorer people who couldn't afford to leave, rural mullahs, increasingly detached from local power sources. And the earlier generation of either Islamists or communists had taken, of course, extremely heavy casualties in the fighting of the 1980s. There is a sense in which the Taliban represented a generational revolt of younger men, poor men, rural men, or men growing up poor in refugee camps, against the older generation of Mujahideen, who became increasingly violent and corrupt. They became warlords. And remember also that phenomenon of the 20-year lag. You start off with some education, and then 20 years later, or in this case more like 15 years later, you get some kind of social consequence. Here they are, various Taliban. This is the only extant photograph of Mullah Omar, who is their leader. It's the only photograph that exists. He, put it mildly, shuns publicity. So where did they come from? They were backed by Pakistan. This logo is the logo of the ISI, the Pakistani Intelligence Services. From the beginning, Pakistani military and intelligence elite saw the Taliban as a counterweight to the Northern Alliance, largely Tajik and too closely friendly to India in their view. And this had long been the case, that the Pakistanis favored the Pushtuns as opposed to the Tajiks, and the Southerners as opposed to the Northerners. So the Pakistanis, given their own conception of their own national interests that we talked about in the last time, unsurprisingly supported these people. They were also supported by something called the trucking mafia. That is to say, the only way goods go in and out of southern Afghanistan is by truck. These trucks go over not very good roads in and out of Pakistan, People trade on both sides of the border. Most people don't think the border is all that legitimate in the first place. They speak the same language, Pushtu, or sometimes some other languages, but they go back and forth. And of course, there are networks of truckers, small companies, families, groups. These people's business was being hammered by the anarchy that broke out, because Mujahideen would set up arbitrary checkpoints and simply shake down truckers. They would shake them down, and if you didn't pay them, they'd kill you. And you can't have your drivers being shot and robbed all the time and run a reasonable trucking business. So the trucking industry decided, you know, we don't like this, and we're good Muslims, and we're Pushtun, and we think this has got to stop. And then along came these organized young fanatics, and they said, you know what, we'll get order. They said, okay, we like this. This is all right. Okay, we'll give you money. Both of them wanted order established in the Kandahar region. They moved beyond the original base because the Pakistanis wanted a centralized but relatively weak state, and they hoped for the construction of a pipeline. Let's think about the Taliban as a social movement. There is an interesting possible comparison with the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia, which was also a movement led by obscure intellectuals who then placed themselves at the head of a large movement of traumatized young men. Young men who, in the case of Cambodia, were traumatized because of constant aerial bombing by the United States Air Force, and in the case of Afghanistan, for reasons we've already looked at. They typically come from the countryside. There is a way in which, in both cases, there was a kind of revenge of the countryside, of the poor rural boys, against the urban sophisticates of the cities. Mullah Omar's background, for example, is extremely different from the background of the Islamists who led the jihad against the Soviets, like Hikmatyar or Massoud. We saw last time that both of those men came from middle-class backgrounds. They had gone to the university. They were relatively well educated. In one case, Hikmatyar was an engineer, for example. So you get these different kinds of backgrounds. But Mullah Omar was nothing like that. Never been to a university. Educated exclusively in traditional, quote unquote, kinds of places, and much poorer, much less known, much less famous. There were networks then of these poor rural mullahs, Islamic teachers, and dwellers in the refugee camps, and then there was a link with Takfiri extremists of all kinds who also, remember, throughout the war against the Soviets, got ample funding from the Saudis. Just to give you an example, here are some of the Taliban fighters. It looks like these guys would probably belong in junior high school if there were such a thing. But instead, they're toting semi-automatic and not-so-semi-automatic weapons. And fighting. It's worth looking always at people's symbols. This is the Taliban flag, and it's simply the Arabic inscription, "There is no God but God, and Muhammad is the prophet of God." This is the so-called Shahada, or the statement of faith in Islam. Technically speaking, in Islamic law, if you utter that statement, I believe, twice in the presence of Muslim witnesses, that means you are a Muslim. You have affirmed this. This same sacred statement also appears on the flag of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. It is the same thing. So there is this close connection, you can see, just symbolically. And not surprisingly, although recently the Saudis had distanced themselves from the Taliban, unsurprisingly, the Saudis did not dislike the Taliban all that much. So we have a social movement. We have poor young men led by essentially outsider leaders who then move in to a situation of anarchy where various groups are willing to support them. And what they then set about doing between 1994 and 1997 was they set about establishing order in southern Afghanistan. The way they established order was not pretty. But after all, in a society like Afghanistan, how would we expect anything else. The story goes, it may be apocryphal, but it's just as important nevertheless. The story goes that there was a notorious Mujahideen commander in the area around Kandahar who specialized in raping children, both female and male. And that when the Taliban came, they said, this is going to stop. They grabbed him and they hanged him from the barrel of a tank. This is the kind of way that they restored order. They liked to hang guys from construction cranes. They did this in Kabul. They did this wherever they went. They were sending a message. This stops now. Now remember, throughout the history of political thinking, all the way back to Aristotle in the West, or to Confucius in China, or to Al-Ghazali in the Muslim world, thinkers have always said that dreadful though tyranny may be, there is one thing worse than that, and that is anarchy. So the Taliban were tyrannical. They were oppressive, particularly to women, and they reestablished a semblance of order, meaning, for in this case, a world in which you could probably safely send your 10-year-old son to get some food and expect him to return and not be raped in the process. People prefer that that not happen, and so, unsurprisingly, in the Pashtun areas, they began supporting the Taliban. And so the Taliban began to advance. They moved into the north. And this, of course, is going to be a big problem. Because unlike in the Pashtun areas, in the north you have, first of all, people of very different ethnicity, speaking different languages. Although we also know there are some Pashtuns up there who may very well support the Taliban. But for sure, one group is going to despise the Taliban and fight against them, and that, of course, will be the Hazara in the center of the country, who are Shiite Muslims. And remember, the Taliban are Takfiris, and they think that the Hazaras aren't really Muslims, and so you can see that these folks will not get along. They took the city in the north of Mazar-e-Sharif in 1998, and they were brutal as usual. But now they're being brutal to people who don't talk like them, who don't look like them, who don't speak their language, who don't think the same way, and so there's resistance. The Hazaras revolted, and they massacred several thousand Taliban prisoners. And remember, please, it is always important to understand, in talking about these kinds of conflicts, we need to get away from the Western idea to the human idea of there are good guys over here and bad guys over here. People who are traumatized, who are afraid, who are under constant threat of violence, in turn, turn around and commit atrocities. As Machiavelli once said a very long time ago, that men pass from one ambition to another, having first experienced ill treatment inflicted next upon others. Question?
At this point, how many people are there in
the... No one knows the exact number of fighters, but thousands of them. We'll talk more, and we'll look at some maps showing the progress of their advance. Then there are counterattacks, of course, and further massacres. Thousands of Hazaras are killed. Plenty of bad blood for the future. The Taliban killed, I think the number was 7, but I'm not sure of the precise number, Iranian diplomats. And since the Iranians, in the view of the Taliban, who are also Shiites, are not real Muslims, the Iranians were on the brink of war with the Taliban. They mobilized their troops. There were troops on the Iranian frontier. Notice this again. You don't hear much about this as we talk about the Taliban being our enemies, the Iranians being our enemies. And these people themselves don't get along. So, interesting thing to notice. Now, what about oil? Come on. In 1995, huge natural gas deposits had been discovered just north of Afghanistan on the northwest frontier in the country of Turkestan. Both we and the Pakistanis wanted a pipeline to go through Afghanistan. Why? Because the only other ways to get oil, to get gas out of Turkmenistan would either go into China, which is where the actual pipeline, as we've seen, has gone. And we weren't so keen on that. Or it would go through Iran, and we certainly didn't like that. And so the idea was to route it through Afghanistan. Okay? That was the idea. An oil company that has since disappeared through mergers called Unocal was interested in this. They hired various advisors, like Zalmay Khalilzad, who was an American of Afghan origin, who became the U.S. ambassador in Iraq. He was a prominent neocon. And Hamid Karzai, who was the current president of Iraq. Yes.
What did the Unocal turn into?
I believe they were bought out by Exxon. So, but you know, you can't very well put up billions of dollars to build pipelines if the regime in question doesn't have international recognition. This is bad business, not a good business idea, and so there was discussion. And you've seen this map before. This is Turkmenistan, where the gas was. And the idea was, well, maybe it could come in this way, and of course the Pakistanis like this also, because this would then have to go into Pakistan, and that would be good for them, and there would be revenue for them. So there were flirtations between the oil companies and the Taliban, not because people liked the Taliban, but simply because of the logic of political economy. If you want to have investment, you've got to have a government that's recognized for it to work. Yes?
Who was expected to own the pipeline?
The pipeline, that was all very murky. It would probably be the government, but then again, what were the terms? We don't know because they were still negotiating. Who were opposing the Taliban? Northerners. Oh yeah, some Pashtuns too. But especially a coalition of forces composed largely of Tajiks and Uzbeks, allied with the separate Party of Unity, which was the party, the Shia party for the Hazara. They were allied together. And they were driven back militarily into the Tajik areas. Why was that? You think that's a little odd. After all, Massoud had excellent military supplies, as indeed he did. Massoud was a brilliant military leader, as indeed he was. But the Taliban had, many think, considerable assistance from Pakistani military advisors. So once again, one has to look at these connections to come up with some judgment about whether any of this makes any sense later on. They were backed by Russia, by Iran, and note, by India. These facts were not lost on the Pakistanis. And as we'll see, by the summer of 2001, the Northern Alliance had been pushed back into roughly 10% of the area of Afghanistan. Let me say a little more about this man, General Abdul Rashid Dostum, the leader of the Uzbeks, who was a guy fighting for the Northern Alliance, fighting against the Taliban. He was a general. He fought throughout the war on the side of the Soviets. He was in the Afghan government, fighting as a general, commanding troops that were working together with the Soviets, but he switched sides. People do this in these kinds of multilateral situations where there are multiple actors. You're trying to protect yourself, you switch sides, and that is exactly what he did. He switched sides. He joined with Massoud, as we've seen. They took Kabul, they were fighting Hikmatyar, the city was devastated. He goes back and forth. He is also widely regarded as a significant human rights abuser. Not that that's very unusual among Afghan leaders, but that is the case. He is also, from our perspective, one of these classic locally based power wielders. He's the kind of guy that you see in the history of Europe or the history of pre-Tokugawa Japan, local warlords with lots of clout who might aspire to rise to run the whole thing, but at the moment have to be content with just their own area. So that was the situation. In the late 1990s, this is a map of Afghanistan, of course, and what you can see is the yellow shows areas more or less controlled by the Taliban, and the green, notice, is the Northern Alliance broken up into different pieces. Here are the folks fighting for Rashid Dostum, the Uzbek. This is where the this was Massoud's people. He was technically under this man named Bernardin Rabbani, but he was the military leader. And over here, the guy from Herat named Ismail Khan, who'd been driven out of Herat by the Taliban. So that was the situation. Okay? And then, of course, came 9/11. And this change turned everything upside down. Again, what happened after 9/11? The short story is, Americans lost it. We went nuts. There was everywhere, rage was everywhere, on the television, in the newspapers, on the internet, on the radio, and there were calls for revenge from essentially all quarters. Little good typically comes from acting out of such rage. There was a denial, really quite hysterical denial, of any historical context. The narrative that was offered to the American people was that these people are evil and they're just bad. Indeed, as John Gray said, there was a very weird theology that gripped Americans, very much at variance with, for example, Roman Catholic theology, but it was a kind of theology that said evil is uncaused. It just kind of is there. Well, that's strange. Where did it come from? Anyway, if you said this, they would call you a traitor. I know, because I did. We refused to treat 9/11 as a criminal justice problem. We called it a war instead. And right at the very beginning, in October, right after 9/11, a man named Sir Michael Howard, who is, as his title implies, a knight of the British Empire, one of the world's most famous military historians, gave a speech in which he denounced the whole concept of a war on terror as being fundamentally opposed to Western interests. This was a crazy way, he said, to define this, and it doesn't make any sense. Treat this as a criminal problem, not as a military problem. You will do much better, and of course, he was ignored. So a decision was taken in Washington to overthrow the Taliban regime. Now, the Taliban were not part of the plot for 9/11 so far as we know. They did, however, very decidedly harbor Osama bin Laden in their territory. There were some desultory negotiations between the Taliban and the United States. The Taliban claimed, and to this day, important Pakistani sources like Hamid Ghul, a former chief of the ISI, said just a few weeks ago in an interview on English Al Jazeera, he said, well, you know, what they really did was they said, yeah, we are willing to have this guy tried, but you've got to present evidence that he's got to be tried our way, namely under Islamic law. Needless to say, in the atmosphere of 9/11, the American government was never going to allow this, and so the decision was taken to overthrow the Taliban regime. Now, there are, as we've seen, other reasons for this. The decision to overthrow the government of Iraq had already been taken before 9/11, we now know, and 9/11, however, provided a very convenient opportunity to persuade the American public that this fiasco was in their interest. And last but not least, Donald Rumsfeld, Secretary of Defense at the time, wanted to demonstrate this idea of the revolution in military affairs that we talked about in the previous lecture. And there was a great deal of talk, really quite blood-curdling talk, about bombing Afghanistan back to the Stone Age. So this is what we should do out of revenge. The famous Indian novelist, Booker Prize winner, and political activist Arundhati Roy had this to say at the time. In America, there's been rough talk of bombing Afghanistan back to the Stone Age. Please break the news that they're already there. And America played no small part, as we saw last Tuesday, in helping it on its way. And so the decision was made. Question. Stay tuned. Stay tuned. Operation Enduring Freedom is then launched. How did this work? First prong, use the Air Force to bomb the Taliban extensively, which we did. Then send commando units to provide ground support to the Northern Alliance in a highly targeted manner. The Northern Alliance then advances and seizes the major cities, including Kabul. That was what happened, and that was the extent of what happened in official political discourse in the United States. But there was a fourth component, which happened at the time, the Pakistani intelligence service told the Taliban, don't fight, fade away, don't do it. This is, you'll lose. Some of them did it anyway, some of them fought anyway, but others decided, okay, we'll run away and live to fight another day. So we had special forces shown here, you know, in good Beaujeu fashion, riding with the Northern Alliance. We bombed them extensively, of course. Other people get hurt in bombs. And, of course, unsurprisingly, the Taliban were no match for the United States Air Force and no match for the Northern Alliance with the full backing of the military of the United States. And they, since particularly it seems that quite a few of them had the idea that, look, let's not fight right now, let's wait. Classic guerrilla strategy. Absolutely classic. But, of course, we proclaimed that it was a famous victory. This is what George W. Bush had to say about this revolution in military affairs. Rewriting the rules of war sounded very good in 2002. Everyone believed it. Doesn't sound so good in 2010, now does it? But that's what we did. And then, of course, you knew this was coming. Now we have to get into the nitty-gritty of setting up a state. It's very easy for the United States military to overthrow states. This is not a problem. We can easily smash states. The problem is, what can we put in their place and how do we do this? Because, of course, we have all these pesky historical details. We all have all this troubling, these troubling difficulties with revenue. We have all these annoying social cleavages when people don't get along. So we set up a kind of rentier state. There's an analyst named Alex DeWall at the Social Science Research Council in New York City who talked about basically what we did was we supplied the revenue ourselves. We flew the money in, literally. We did this, as we'll see later, in Iraq as well. We are talking C-130s, the giant American transport planes, the transport material, filled with shrink-wrapped packages of $100 bills on pallets. Literally, flown in, huge amounts of this. More on this later. The Office of Management and Budgetment, the General Accounting Office, did a study of this in Iraq and what happened to the money. Short answer, we have no clue. But we'll talk about that when we talk about Iraq. So this was what people thought at the time. Well, now it's established, and notice the title, the Taliban Surrender. But actually, of course, the Taliban did nothing of the kind. Some Taliban fought and was killed or captured or defeated, while the Taliban just disappeared. And part of the problem in the Pashtun areas was many of the Taliban were just local folks. So put your Kalashnikov, bury your Kalashnikov in a blanket in the garden and wait. And then maybe something else will happen. But that was the idea. The Northern Alliance then comes into Kabul, shown here, coming in on trucks, riding on armored personnel carriers and so forth. And as is typical in wars, atrocities were the norm. This photograph, taken by a UPI photographer, I believe, shows Northern Alliance soldiers dragging off a Taliban to be shot. Okay? Now, this is, of course, in violation of the Geneva Conventions, but to put it mildly, the Geneva Conventions on war move at something of a discount in civil wars everywhere. And meanwhile, of course, something else happened. They failed to get Osama bin Laden. He was in the mountains on the border between Pakistan and Afghanistan, and he somehow slipped away. We still don't have the full details of this. Various stories, there are various journalistic accounts. They're the best we've got so far, but until 25 years from now, when archives are declassified, we're not really going to know exactly what happened. Suffice it to say, he got away. It's not too surprising. They had a lot of supporters up in this area. This is an extremely mountainous area. The Pakistani government on the Pakistan side has never, repeat, never exercised direct control of this area until very recently under our prodding. They're sending troops in there. So it's very rugged and mountainous, riddled with caves and tunnels, so not too surprising that Americans who had never been to a place like this were outfoxed by locals who've lived there all their lives. And so now we set about setting up a new government, which we then set about to do. And here's Hamid Karzai, a Pashtun, becomes the leader. And you say, why did they pick a Pushtun? Because they had to. Because historically, since the early 19th century, every official head of state of Afghanistan has been a Pushtun. And even though the Tajiks are sort of the power behind the throne, they can't be the direct nominal leaders. What was the power structure? Fundamentally, the Northern Alliance, this coalition of a variety of warlords and the so-called international community, particularly the United States and NATO. So, in effect, the Americans and some sprinkling of allies try to establish a monopoly on violence and then try to set up a state. And this state, as you could predict, given what you've learned so far in this class, will not be very effective. Why? What's the recipe for failure here? First, the structural weakness of reliance on the Northern Alliance. What's wrong with that? Point one, where did the Taliban in the South come from in the first place? Loathing of the populace for warlords who would rape and pillage and loot, very violent men, gangsters, right? State-making is organized crime. And these guys were organized criminals. Everybody, that's the way states work everywhere in the world. So that was one problem. And furthermore, they're disproportionately Tajik, Uzbek, and Hazara. Fine for Tajiks, Uzbeks, and Hazaras. Not so popular amongst Pushtuns. And last but hardly least, this state from the beginning was deeply distrusted by Pakistan, who, many would say, have never stopped supporting the Taliban. Maybe they shifted a little bit in the last 6 months, but even that is certainly subject to doubt. I think myself, they're just supporting them in a smarter way to protect their own interests. And then we shifted our focus to Iraq. We decided in our wisdom that it would be a good idea to intervene in a state that had been riven from its foundation by deep internecine conflicts with massive violence as a theme throughout their history. We thought we could make it into a Jeffersonian democracy, and so in our wisdom, we did this. We'll talk in the next several lectures about just what folly that was. And the Republican administration of George W. Bush was very hostile to the idea of nation building. Now, in this, this is not entirely an absurd position. If the notion says, look, outsiders are really quite incapable of overcoming these deep internal conflicts which we have seen over and over and over again have deep historical roots, well, in that sense, that's absolutely true. Outsiders cannot do very much about that. Sometimes you can balance it a little bit, and then you can give certain kinds of assistance, but you're not going to be an outsider and fix the underlying structural features of a society. And, of course, the Taliban had simply been pushed over the Durand Line into Pakistan. So then there's international failure led by us. Aid, we pledged $10.4 billion in aid. This was a third of all the aid that was pledged by some 80 countries, and the total amount that was actually disbursed was less than half that. Military spending, by contrast, in the Afghan War at that time, it's considerably higher now, as we'll see momentarily, was $36 billion per year. The Afghan government said, we really need $50 billion. This place is a wreck. It's been wrecked. It's been completely wrecked. It was poor to begin with. It's been completely devastated by 20 years of warfare, starting in 1979 all the way until now. In 2002, this place is a mess, it's been wrecked, we need a lot of money, nobody pledged it. Only a third of this aid was going through the government. And here you get a kind of dialectic. The government is weak, and as we'll see, quite corrupt. So Americans who don't like that don't want to funnel the money and say, well, that'll just go into the hands of these corrupt guys. So therefore we do it. But then, are we the state in this country? Are we the people creating this state? That's a problem. Certainly isn't going to be very popular with the liberals, and for in the long run, is clearly not sustainable. So that was the kind of contradiction that it set up, and as a consequence of their large number of U.S. forces, as a consequence of our domination through money and so forth of the way many aspects of the African government worked, it was increasingly became perceived as an occupation. Not everywhere. Depends on the region, depends on the place. This is a very diverse country, but particularly in the Pashtun areas, it became so perceived. It's interesting to contrast, by the way, what the international community has contributed in development assistance right after a big conflict per person elsewhere in the world. In East Timor, next to Indonesia, there was a horrifying set of violence when the Indonesian military basically said, you can't be independent. The Timorese said, well, we want to be. Mass, all kinds of carnage. Finally, a deal is negotiated. It becomes independent. And this shows the per capita aid given to East Timor or Bosnia at the conclusion. And look at Afghanistan, right? Where, if anything, the problems were much more serious. For example, literacy in both East Timor and Bosnia was way higher, much, much higher than it was in the case of Afghanistan. So the amount of aid being given was not enough. It wasn't being funneled to the government, and it was promised but not dispersed. But there's a further problem. And here, I'm sad to say, I speak from direct personal experience, having worked many times for the United States Agency for International Development. There is a number of cultural, bureaucratic problems with the way we do development assistance. Here's a little diagram that shows how it works. We funnel money from the Congress to contractors. These are independent U.S. companies. I once worked for one of these. And these contractors have a contract. That's what they say. They have a contract. And then this contract says, okay, go out there and do things. But remember, these are American companies. They're used to doing things the American way. So what do? We build things with specifications and so on that are as familiar. We do what we're good at. But what we're good at and what fits a radically different society may be two different things. For instance, we build things which require maintenance. It's a feature of U.S. aid that money is only allocated for construction. No money for maintenance. That's the responsibility of the local government. But remember, we're dealing here with local governments that have a very weak tax base. So they don't have very much revenue. They don't have very much money for maintenance. And we build fancy American things that require a lot of maintenance. But it's a recipe for failure. Furthermore, not only may they not have the money, they may not have the personnel. If these things are relatively technologically sophisticated, maybe they don't have the kind of people who have been trained how to maintain these things. And so it doesn't work. Meanwhile, since if you're regarded as an occupation, insurgents make it their business to blow up things you have built. So the needs aren't met for both of these reasons, and more aid is allocated and round and around and around. It's a problem. And state making, then, now, is organized crime. One way organized crime works is you break bones. Another way organized crime works is you pay people off. You make payments. And the Taliban had shown, this quote asserts, that the Taliban had only kinship and faith. We had only cash. Now, actually, as we'll see in a bit, the Taliban also had cash. But if the Taliban have kinship, faith, and cash, and we have only cash, that's going to be the problem. And so we set up bases along with our NATO allies, and increasingly we became viewed as occupiers. There's a NATO project, the number of forces, overwhelmingly Americans. There are other countries represented, but as you can see, there are very small numbers. And we set up bases all around in Afghanistan. We also have bases now in Pakistan. We have an air base in Kyrgyzstan, etc. Now, the problem is, of course, occupations are unpopular. They become unpopular very quickly. One reason they become unpopular is because the members of the government may be corrupt and so forth. We'll talk about that in a moment. But the real reason, the big reason why occupations become unpopular is because people get killed. This photograph shows an atypical Pushtun compound and U.S. forces coming in, not intending any harm to this guy, intending to be looking for Taliban. But now just think about it. Probably one, at best, of these soldiers speaks some Pushtun, maybe not even. This guy speaks no English, and all of a sudden, these people who look like they came out of Star Wars to him, right, are suddenly crashing into his house. Oh my, then they're foreigners, and what are they doing here? And oh my God, okay? Breaking down doors, particularly in Muslim societies where the sanctity of the home is very important, this is not a popular thing to do. But then, of course, any military tries to protect the lives of its own soldiers. And this, in the case of the United States military, means deployment of massive firepower. We're very good at this, and we can deploy massive firepower to protect our soldiers. But the trouble is, in war, there's always fog. As Clausewitz said more than 200 years ago, there's always fog in the world, there's always confusion, and consequently, innocent people get killed, and our bombs fall on houses, and there are funerals, and they don't like this, to put it mildly. And so this then further made there are more attacks on our soldiers who begin to think that everybody's against them. A siege mentality sets in. And you can see this. Notice, there are no bad guys here. This is the way it works when these kinds of forces are unleashed. These soldiers, understandably, are scared. They are worried, and they feel that everyone's trying to kill them, and their goal is simply to get home alive. And it's equally clear that the people here, mourning loved ones, are going to be very angry, particularly in a Pushtun society where there is something called the Pushtun Wali, which is their tribal code, which requires any male to revenge the murder of any other male. If they define this as murder, and you can see how they might, this then sets up a kind of revenge cycle. And last but not least, you know, we have this problem. This guy, it's a photograph from Vanity Fair. I just love this. An American sergeant, he has infidel tattooed on his chest. He's collecting fingerprints for a database. This is not going to go down very well. And of course, from the rubble comes the revival of the Taliban, called by some analysts the Neo-Taliban, who emerged. What do they say about what they're doing? Wall Street Journal interviewed this man, one Ghulam Yahya, and asked him, what's this about? He says, they come in here, they're looking after their own interests, they're disrespecting our culture, they're bombing and killing innocent people, and basically, we're not going to stand for it, we're going to resist them. So we get the rise of the Neo-Taliban. Pushtun opinion turns increasingly against the United States and the government because of this breaking down of doors phenomenon, the civilian casualties from airstrikes, and our reliance on local, typically rather violent warlords whom they don't much care for either. Then there are ethnic conflicts. Despite President Karzai, many Pushtuns perceive the current Afghan state as being essentially a Tajik state. And as we'll see when we look at the composition of the military, this is not altogether an absurd notion. And remember, the structural feature of the way the Pakistani security elite defined their own national interests remains unchanged. They think of Afghanistan as their vulnerable back. They don't want anything there that will help what they are obsessed with their perceived threat from India. So that's the bottom line for them. Now, all of this could have been familiar to any student of history. The man who was the chief of staff after Bulgakov went out is this man, Apolmeyev. What did he say? Soviet soldiers are everywhere in Afghanistan. We're all over the place, he said. But as soon as we leave, skin, it comes back, and they restore it to the way it was before. This is not particularly different from American experience, as was observed by the Russian ambassador. 2 years ago, less than 2 years ago, he said, they've repeated all of them, but now they've got new ones. We don't have the copyright on those. Okay? This guy, by the way, probably knows what he's talking about. He was the head of the KGB in the Soviet intelligence service in Kabul during the war. Okay? So probably he knows something about this. Okay? But there it is. And so the war then spreads. Because when you push these guys over the border, and you've got all that global jihad underway, and the Americans are throwing our weight around and enraging Muslim opinion in lots of places, it spreads. And in Waziristan and these mountainous areas in Pakistan, people begin demonstrating. Okay? So where this place is, up here, this was nominally, notice, it's on the Pakistani side of the Durand Line, but remember the Durand Line was just a line drawn by a surveyor, right? By a British surveyor. In fact, the government of British India before it, and the Pakistani government after it, has never, until the last few months, actually sent organs of the Pakistani state, like police, like army, into these areas. Instead, it was a kind of, you guys run your own affairs, we won't mess with you, you don't mess with us. It's a sort of semi, they're not independent, but it's a very isolated, very mountainous, arid place where it has had a history of generations of resisting any kind of outsider, whatever. Okay? So, we get spreading violence. Notice violence not just on the Afghan side, but also spilling over into Pakistan. Now, in the one of my favorite movies, Chinatown, there Jack Nicholson plays the detective, and he says, 9 times out of 10, if you follow the money, it will lead you to the truth. So we need to follow the money of the Afghan state and the Taliban. Where are they getting this money? Well, in short, we don't know all of it, but here's one place they're definitely getting it. Think about Afghanistan. It has nothing to export. Remember King Nader Shah, what was he trying to export? Well, hides, cotton, textiles, rugs, not big money makers, right? But dope is a much better way to get money. The government gets international aid, the warlords siphon off a lot of it, and the country's main export crop is opium. Indeed, Afghanistan now supplies an estimated 90% of global heroin. Okay? It is a narco state, but it's not really a narco state alone because it's a narco state and a narco resistance. Right? So you have both being into this. Some estimates put the output of opium, which of course is a very high value per unit weight and per unit land, at about a third of output in the country. Where is it cultivated? Well, all over, but especially in these southern Pashtun areas, where it also then becomes part of the way the Taliban get their money. Now, it wasn't always like this. It began in the 1980s, but this is a very interesting graph. If we look at world opium production, and this is at the gray is Afghanistan, and notice already it's nearly half, its percentage grows, but then look at this, isn't that funny? All of a sudden, just before 2001, there's a sudden collapse of global opium production. What happened? Well, it collapsed in Afghanistan. Why? The Taliban. The Taliban decided two things. One, opium was haram, was forbidden under Islamic law. And two, the Westerners want this stopped, we'll offer this. We'll say, hey, you want opium stopped? Okay, we'll stop opium. And notice, they were able to do this. Now, I know people in the American intelligence community who think that really what happened was they simply put it in warehouses, waiting to see what would happen. They hedged their bets. And given Afghan history, one can understand why they might. But nevertheless, the Taliban basically banned opium. And remember, if you grow opium and they decide that's a crime, what will they do to you? They'll hang you from a tank barrel. Okay? This is the way the Taliban works. So it provided, shall we say, put in economic language, a disincentive to growing opium under the Taliban. Instant execution does have an impact as an incentive. And so it collapsed, right? And then 9/11 comes along, the Taliban are overthrown, nobody's hanging people from tank barrels anymore for growing opium, and boom, up it goes again. And now, it funds the Taliban. And many think, with some justification, that their statements about this being against Islamic law were hypocritical, because then they turned the light around to growing it, and there's quite a lot of force with that. But there it is. Once again, it's happening. Now, at this current situation in Afghanistan would not be Afghani if the Taliban were the only act in town. We saw that during the war against the Soviets, during the jihad against the Soviets, that the resistance to the Soviets was decentralized, that it was fragmented, very much in keeping with the fragmentation of Afghan society in the first place. And the same thing is true now. There are at least three movements, independent of each other, fighting against the Americans. One are the Taliban. Another is Gulbuddin Hikmatyar, remember, him beloved by the ISI and the Saudis in the 1980s. And then last, there is the Haqqani Network, another character. But that's probably an exaggeration of the degree of unity. It's a different map that shows that typically local commanders have much more control. So again, this has always been the way Afghanistan works for deep historical geographical reasons. Fragmented resistance, decentralized, very difficult not only to create a centralized state, but very difficult to create a centralized resistance movement also. It's fragmented in this kind of way. And here we are now, down here in particular, trying to, quote-unquote, pacify these areas. Now, one big problem that American forces face is how to get material into Afghanistan. Afghanistan is landlocked, so it's got to come in. It can fly in some of it, but that's extremely expensive and difficult. It comes in through the port of Karachi in Pakistan and goes in through Pakistan, and these trucks, particularly up here and here, have been repeatedly attacked by Taliban setting ambushes, trying to cut this off. And so what we get is a spreading insurgency. A think tank that specializes in global security affairs has a series of really nice maps that kind of show it. This is in 2007, with the Taliban having a major presence here. This is in 2008, and this is in 2009. So you get the spread of the Taliban. So much for the famous victory of 2001-2002. So, now what? Maybe here's the number of U.S. troops at the last day of each month. July 2008, 33,000, almost 34,000. These days, let's call it 68,000, exactly a little larger than that. A decision was made in the Obama administration to send in more troops. We'll talk later about why they might have decided to do this. Short answer in advance is, nobody really knows. This is so often in history, but that was the kind of decision that was taken. The journalist Robert Scheer had this to say back in September. He's an old-time journalist, worked in Vietnam. And he said that there was an optimism when the buildup began in Vietnam. I'm old enough to remember that. Talk about elections and local politicians who win the hearts and the minds of the locals. And then turns out, oops, locals are corrupt and this is easily exploited by other folks. And that's a problem. There's a man, a British man, named Rory Stewart, who was a famous adventurer, an adventurous guy. He hitchhiked across Afghanistan during the 1990s. You can see this is not a guy who was not easily intimidated. Right? Hiking through anarchy zones, I don't know, he survived. Then he was hired by the British in Iraq because he spoke Arabic, and he was sent into a certain region to sort of be the British advisor there, and then he was sent out to Afghanistan. He had this to say about what was happening. He said, the analogy is sort of like this, that they, meaning people in the American administration, come to you and say, we decided to drive our car off the cliff and we want to know whether we should use a seatbelt. And we say, no, don't drive your car off the cliff. And they say, no. That decision's already been taken. What we want to know is, should we wear a seatbelt? And then we say, well, by all means, wear a seatbelt. And then they turn around and say, well, we consulted with the policy. And this is it, right? Rory Stewart is now standing for office for the Parliament in England, in elections, for the Conservative Party, actually. So, but this is just, it was typical. I'll tell a personal story at the time. I got a call before Obama was inaugurated from a friend of mine, who I'm not going to tell you who it is. Anyway, it's a friend who works in national security stuff. And he was an advisor to the Obama campaign, and he said, maybe we're going to set up some kind of a meeting. And I said, okay, maybe. The meeting never happened, to talk about different views about conflict between the Americans and the Muslim world. And I expressed, you know, I was feeling good. This was December, right? A year ago, December of 2009, Obama had just been elected. And I said, well, you know, it's true that there are a lot of problems because although it's like there's this super tanker, the ship of state of the United States, and we're headed for this giant iceberg, but at least now we've got a reasonable guy up there in the main deck. I mean, the captain is now a reasonable person. He's not saying, yee-haw, bring him on, you know, full steam ahead. So I was expressing some optimism. My friend went silent on the line. And after a long time, he said, Alan, the rudder is broken. So, let's see whether he might have been right. Because after all, there's a question. We call ourselves a democracy. Maybe a plutocracy, ruled by the rich, would be better. But maybe also we're an idiocracy. David Broder of the Washington Post, widely regarded as the dean of the Washington Press Corps, had this statement that the Cheshire Cat would find very congenial. Whether or not the decision, does this make any sense to you at all? Certainly doesn't to me. Anyway, that's what it is. So, what kind of quagmire have we gotten ourselves into? Well, first of all, of course, as Robespierre famously said before he was guillotined during the French Revolution, nobody loves armed missionaries. Only 18%, according to one poll, support increased troops. And the Carnegie Institute for International Peace, headquartered in Washington, believes that the presence of foreign troops is probably the single most important factor in the resurgence. Then there was an election. Last fall, there was an election in Afghanistan. These folks, writing in Foreign Policy, I know this man, Marvin Weinbaum, is formerly a professor of politics and political science at the University of Illinois, now works in retirement for the Middle East Institute in Washington, speaks Pashto, Dari, and a few other Afghan languages, worked on the country all his life. He says, industrial-scale effort to distort the election. What happened? The elements set up polling centers that don't exist, and then the folks supervising it are in your pocket. What about the ghost polling stations? Well, 1,500 polling centers under the control of the Taliban, who said, don't vote, no election, we don't approve elections, this is bad, we don't like this government. These centers actually never existed, but since nobody could get there, again, you couldn't prove the negative. You couldn't prove they didn't exist, they said, and consequently it was easy to say they were open, and hundreds of thousands of votes were recorded. The European Union sent election monitors. These are highly competent people, to put it mildly. They said that over a one-third of the votes cast for the president were probably fraudulent. So we have a government put in that is suspicious, many people find suspicious in the country to begin with. Very large and growing American presence, in a country that has a history of not being very keen on having outsiders running around their country, although I'm not sure what country is so keen, but anyway. And so we come up with a new idea. New is in quotes. Counterinsurgency. As opposed to anti-insurgency. The basic concept goes back to the Vietnam War. Indeed, it goes back to the British in Malaya. Clear. Use military force to seize territory. That's the old style. Sure, you do that. But you can't stop there, because otherwise the problems that the Russians talked about, you leave, they just come back. So you have to hold it. You remain in the area, and you allow the Afghan government to reestablish its authority. You know that reestablish is in quotes, because in many areas the Afghan central government never had very much authority to begin with. So it's not really about reestablishing it, but that's the way this language works. And then you build. And then you build and launch a development project. And so in this way, the idea is you gain the political support of local people for the government. And this is the concept, at least officially, behind our latest offensive in Helmand province. Remember, this is the same province that we saw last time. This is a major opium growing area. It's really all that remains of that irrigation project we funded in the 1950s. Nir Rosen, a journalist you should always read, his Arabic is amazingly good, and he also speaks Farsi, and so he says, look, American military people aren't trained to do this. People don't study these languages for long enough to get really good at it. People don't understand the complexities of the history and the society that they're sent to. Marines are trained to kill people. That's what it's about. And that's what they're trained to do. So it's not like this is ever going to work out. And consider what General McChrystal, the commander of American forces in Afghanistan, has just said. He said, well, first we go into Helmand, but we've got a government in a box ready to roll in. Two problems. What's in the box? What's looking in the box? Government in the box. Well, what's in this box? And there's always the problem of Pakistan. So let's look at these in turn. First, there's the government in the stuffed ballot box. Right? Now, that kind of box, we know. Notice, February 23rd, a few days ago, the president of Afghanistan has said, the Electoral Commission, the people that supervise us, none of these pesky Europeans running around. No. Future elections, I supervise it. Well, that'll work out well. That's sort of like putting Mayor Richard J. Daley of Chicago, before is the corrupt guy in charge of supervising elections in Chicago. Not a good idea. Okay? So that's the first problem. But then, much more importantly, the American ambassador in that memo, which was classified, which was leaked to the New York Times and Washington Post, which I forwarded to you by email, has this to say about the nature of the Afghan state. There is no there. And you already know that this makes perfect sense. This is not accidental. This is not because of the doings of one or two bad people. This is because of the geography and the history of Afghanistan. This is the way it is. Few indigenous sources of revenue. No revenue, no state. No independent revenue controlled by those seeking to wield a monopoly on violence, and no independent state, full stop. Few means to distribute it. Why? No administrative apparatus. No functioning bureaucracy. The same sorts of things that had to be created over generations in Europe, in Japan, in China, and elsewhere in the world. And little or no political will or capacity to carry out. So what happens instead? We have this. We give money to warlords. That's fine. They like that. They can grow more opium. They sell it to us. They get more money. They get stronger. But the Taliban also resists. The war goes on. And around the world we go. Here's an example of democracy at work. This man is Ahmed Walid Karzai. He's the half-brother of the president. He is a well-known drug trafficker. And now it turns out he has for years been on the payroll of the Central Intelligence Agency. So how corrupt is this government? Now, of course, there are different ways of measuring this, but helpfully, there is a non-governmental organization called Transparency International, which is headquartered in Berlin, Germany. And they do systematic studies, basically in order to provide advice to investors about the relative lack of corruption or presence of corruption in countries everywhere in the world. And they have an index, and it goes from 1, which is the lowest possible number, and low is good. I think New Zealand is like a 3. We're like a 25. Okay? And then it goes all the way up to 180. So that's the scale. So higher number means more corrupt. Here's what's been happening in Afghanistan. 2005, they kicked in at 119. They then rose to 145, and now I believe they're somewhere around, they are at 179. Okay? And actually, so now they are the second most corrupt government, according to Transparency International, in the world. But one proviso has to be made here. That assumes that actually that's a fair comparison, because the most corrupt government in the world, according to them, is the government of Somalia. Actually, Somalia does not have a government. There is no government in Somalia. So it's a somewhat unfair comparison, but nevertheless, you get the idea of the kind of lead we're dealing with. Okay? Not such good news. Here's an example. Police chiefs on the border pay $150,000 to get your job. That's a lot of money in Afghanistan. So you need bribes and narco smugglers in order to pay it, and that's good. Here are some of the police at work. They're often poorly trained, rarely paid, they're watching the road. Where do they get their money? Well, they get their money by shaking down traffic and other things. And actually, it goes a little beyond corruption. Patrick Coburn, the famous Irish journalist who, like many Irish, is trained in the British mode of speech, has this to say. Notice the British understatement, a tradition which has tended to alienate villagers. You might think, yeah, maybe. So, a problem. There is a problem, in short, of the missing state in Afghanistan. Under Secretary of State George Ball, said in 1965 that the government of Saigon is a travesty. He said it's a country with an army and no government. So what's the difference with Afghanistan? Answer, in Afghanistan, there's not really a functioning army either. What does the army look like? 70% of the troops are illiterate. Tajiks overwhelmingly dominate the officer corps. Desertion rates are at least 20% and higher if there's any shooting. According to the Pakistani journalist and expert on Afghanistan, Ahmed Rashid, not a single brigade is self-sufficient or combat ready. Only 3% of these recruits come from the Pashtun belt in the south. It is, in short, an illiterate, understaffed army composed of non-Pashtuns. And this is what's supposed to roll in behind the Americans in the Pashtun areas to establish order. Good luck with that. Oh, and one last thing. You know, you can get rid of the heroin users, but not the smokers. Nobody would be left. And it's an army they can never afford. Here's the cost of the Afghan army. Here's the total revenue of the government. This is disproportionate. This does not look like it's going to work very well. So, what are we stuck with? Well, we're stuck with continuing to fund this. Where is that gap going to come from? You. It's going to come from the American taxpayers. And at the same time, of course, we will preach to them about the necessity of purity. We will talk to them about the necessity to avoid corruption. Zbigniew Brzezinski had this to say about our preaching about corruption in governance to other countries. It's a bit of a problem. I mean, consider banker bonuses, Congress, which, to put it mildly, isn't exactly immune to special interests. This is widely known internationally. People know about this. And yet, we think we should just quit. And remember, quagmires are expensive. One soldier, it's estimated by the Congressional Research Service, about $1.3 million a year, just do the arithmetic.
$88.4 billion per year. So notice the disconnect. Notice the sum of money, your money, being used, and notice how well this is likely to work out, given what you can see about the history of Afghanistan. This is not what you're worried about. As Bob Herbert said, opportunity costs are everywhere. We've got a lot of problems, like at the University of California, for example, or high schools, or closing down teen centers to keep kids off the streets and doing having medical care and on rebuilding infrastructure. We could do things with $88 billion, don't you think? Maybe we could, anyway. And last but not least, there's the Pakistani problem. Paul Pillar, National Intelligence Officer, what that means is he's the analyst in chief for a region in the CIA. That's what the National Intelligence Officer is. This guy, Paul Pillar, now retired, was the National Intelligence Officer for this region in the CIA, and he says, the reason we're supposedly in Afghanistan, the reason we care so much, is because of instability in Pakistan. But the government of this Pakistan is simultaneously helping the people that are fighting us. Seems a little odd. How do the Pakistanis look at it? Well, what's the greatest threat? Al-Qaeda? India? Not so good. And demonstrations continue. What are the Pakistanis worried about? I love Google Earth. You just put in, these are Indian consulates, not just in where they have an embassy in Kabul, of course, but they've said in consulates. I am not against India having consulates in Afghanistan, but if you're a security planner in Rawalpindi, in Karachi, in Pakistan, you care about this. You worry. There's a book. You can't get it in a bookstore, but it is in libraries, called The Bear Trap. It was written by a man named Mohammad Hussain. He was a high-ranking Pakistani intelligence officer, and he wrote about the war as a trap, that it was a deliberate. And we saw the trap was indeed part of the reason why the United States helped fund the Mujahideen was precisely to trap the Soviets. We, in effect, tried to win the Cold War over the bodies of dead Afghans. Well, that's the old trap. What's the new trap? Here's Ayman Zawahiri, second in command to Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda. He says, if they leave, they lose. If they stay, they lose. Many think that this was part of the strategy from the beginning. They didn't think that blowing up buildings in New York City was going to do anything to cause the United States to collapse. These men are way too smart for that. But they thought maybe what will happen is the Americans will overreact, and out of that overreaction will come all kinds of possibility. So-called terrorists in the 19th century in Russia called it propaganda of the deed. You do something that then gets other people to do things, and then you get to say, see, we told you so. Now all of this is brutal and cynical. Okay? And yet, this may be part of the problem. But there's also a way in which Zawahiri may be wrong. It's not at all obvious. The second sentence is not obvious. It is not obvious that if we leave, we will have lost everything. That depends on what it is that everything means. Is there a way out of this? We could, and there are some signs of this starting, negotiate with the Taliban. Problem is, we don't, of course, we have no use for Al-Qaeda and their ilk. How closely connected are the Taliban? And the answer is, nobody knows, and it changes, and you know why. Because the Taliban is not a centralized movement. This is not like, say, a Leninist organization, as was the National Liberation Front in Vietnam, with strict, rigid, hierarchical discipline. This is not the way this works here. So some of them may be friendly to Al-Qaeda, some of them are not. And do you think outsiders like Americans are going to be able to tell? Well, I doubt this very much. There's a notion of maybe we could copy Iraq. We don't know enough about Iraq, although I'll go through a little bit of that in just a second. And we're looking for the exit. We're clearly trying to figure out a way to get out of this, but there are many issues.
tensions between India and Pakistan. They've only been there since the 1850s, between Muslims and Hindus. And they've only been around for at least 50 years as organized states. That's a big problem. There are indeed links between Taliban and Al-Qaeda. And then we don't get along well at all, put it mildly, with the Islamic Republic of Iran, about which more in subsequent lectures. So there's a kind of notion that, well, it all worked in Iraq. Now, we'll see that it all worked in Iraq is actually a deliciously idiotic thing to say, but we'll talk about that subsequently. First of all, though, there's some huge differences. Iraq is overwhelmingly urban. Afghanistan is overwhelmingly rural. Afghanistan has never been governed, and as we will see starting soon, indeed in this lecture, Iraq has always had a strong and violent centralized state. And one of the big reasons is one state doesn't have any oil, and one state does. If you have big oil rents, you can build a powerful state. If you don't, it's a lot tougher to do. There's a history of kicking invaders out in Afghanistan, no comparable history. Organized insurgency in Iraq, multiple competing insurgencies. Some people in Washington think, well, we can just kind of pull back and kind of bomb them, you know, send these drones in. But it's a big problem. Pakistan will always be a player in Afghan politics, and they have strong links to the Pashtuns and links to various pieces of the Taliban. The Indians and the Russians have long had close link with the Tajiks. Remember, please, in the Soviet Union, there was a Tajik Soviet Republic. Part of Tajikistan was part of the Soviet Union for three generations. They have very close link with the Tajiks. Same thing is true with the Uzbeks and Russia. Iran has close links with the Hazaras because of their shared religious views. To really get violence stopped, you need a deal among all of these. And that, to put it mildly, is a tall order. So we can ask, what do we want? One hypothesis is we're seeking to stay around long enough to capture Osama bin Laden, declare a victory, and come home. This would be, I'd be really okay with that. That'd be great. Nice to capture him in the first place. He is obviously a serious international criminal. But additionally, it would be very good to do this because then it would provide a way to persuade the American people that getting out of a destructive, sick, bloody sinkhole that is sucking up $80 billion a year is an okay thing to do. This would be fine. Okay? But remember, global jihad, attack theory jihadism, is not just one man. This is a global movement. It is a social movement. It is an ideology. And the removal of one man, however charismatic, does not get rid of an ideology. You could capture the entire Al-Qaeda leadership in Pakistan, and there would still be all kinds of difficulties. Maybe the idea is defeat Taliban and create a client state. We're just going to stay there forever. We get rid of them somehow, and then we stay and we fund because they won't have the revenue. We'll have to provide the revenue. You can see this is not sustainable because there will be casualties. At some point, Americans will increasingly turn against the war. That's already happening. It's happening on a larger scale in Europe. This will not go on indefinitely. And the Taliban know this. And the Pakistani intelligence service know this. And for that matter, so do the Indians. And so do the Russians. Everybody knows that sooner or later, the Americans will have to leave because they're so far away. And so everybody is trying to figure out and position themselves what to do next. Maybe we want to stabilize and secure Pakistan. And again, this is something of a fool's errand. Pakistan is a huge country, much bigger than any of these countries. And it has, again, its own history, its own internal problems, a very highly developed elite in security services, in military, in all kinds of other fields. We are not going to fix this country. Maybe we're trying to get some kind of a deal and go home. Myself, I basically think there are two hypotheses about why the Obama administration did this. I'll give you the optimistic hypothesis first and the pessimistic hypothesis second. The optimistic hypothesis works like this.
It says that President Obama is a highly intelligent, put it mildly, individual who understands all this perfectly well. He can see perfectly well that this can't work. But he has a huge problem. Historically, in terms of American electoral politics, every time American troops went into some conflict and then came out, the American right wing then accused the Democrats of not being sufficiently patriotic, it somehow being patriotic to waste lives and treasure, but that's the way it's spun. And he doesn't want that to happen. He doesn't want to be people who lost Afghanistan as if it were hard to lose, but never mind. He's trying to avoid that. And so this optimistic scenario continues. What he's trying to do is have some kind of surge in troops. It's really kind of a cosmetic event. Have this, run around the country, make it look like things are going well, hopefully maybe capture a few guys, get the Pakistanis on board to do some kind of a deal with some members of the Taliban, and then say, okay, that's it, we're out here. That's the optimist. I hope that's what's actually going on. The pessimistic view is that my friend is right about the rudder being broken. Remember when we talked about sources of militarism in the United States? One of the pieces wasn't just neoconservatives, although to put it mildly, they are a big problem. Another piece is liberal interventionism. The inventor of American liberal interventionism was, after all, the Democratic president Woodrow Wilson. This notion that we, as the shining city on the hill, can spread the values of civic nationalism everywhere in the world is a deeply held belief among American foreign policy elites. It is possible, the second hypothesis goes, that that is the version into which the Obama administration buys, and that they really think that they're going to be able to create some kind of a stable state in a country like Afghanistan. There is a third possible hypothesis, offered by William Pfaff, that basically we are drifting. We really don't have any idea what we're doing. This happens much more than you think in Washington. Someone has some kind of very difficult problem, is inherited, and then different bureaucracies do different things. The Pentagon is the most powerful bureaucracy. They do a certain thing. So they sort of say, well, nobody knows what to do. Okay, well, we'll do it our way. And since no one really knows what to do, and everybody's distracted by all kinds of other political things, there's healthcare, there's climate change, there's the banking problems. So people are kind of distracted, and policy, in other words, is not something that's thought of and figured out in advance. Policy is something that emerges in a kind of haphazard evolutionary style out of the competition of different bureaucracies and political forces. And often, particularly in cases like this, it actually doesn't make any sense because really no one is in charge. So there is a problem. The beginning of looking at Afghanistan, we looked at this slide. You get the collapse of states and conflict explodes. Outsiders are tempted to intervene, even to invade. But then what happens? They find the country inhospitable and ungovernable. They withdraw. Internal conflict escalates. And then some other group establishes. I mean, just because if we were to leave Afghanistan, do not think that then peace will be at hand in Afghanistan. Peace has not been at hand in Afghanistan in a very long time. Certainly, it has gotten very, very dramatically worsened by the invasion of the Soviets and ever since then. But at some point, maybe something would settle out, rather like the 1950s or something. But then the outsiders are tempted to intervene, and on it goes. The old Mujahid Ismail Khan, who, remember, fights the Taliban. He doesn't like this. This guy is no Taliban. It's possible we should listen. Now, one last thing can be said about Afghanistan. You can see that this is, I think, a textbook case in The March of Folly, a book written by Barbara Tuchman a generation ago. You really should read this over a break or something, where she takes the Renaissance popes provoking the Protestant Reformation,
King George III, provoking American independence in the Vietnam War. She defines folly as addiction to the counterproductive. You can see that there is a way in which, even though it doesn't work, we keep doing it. We keep doing it. The Russians did it before us. The British did it before them. And we see that when faced with these structural problems, there are deficiencies. There are no wonder that this happens. It's also true, however, that, after all, 9/11 did happen. Osama bin Laden was there. Having some kind of a stable in Afghanistan would be a good thing. It's not too surprising that from a strategic point of view, people were worried about that. You can make an argument, I think it's a false argument, that in terms of for American global strategy, it might have made some sense. You cannot make that argument for the case of Iraq. Not only, as we will see, will many, many people lose their lives in Iraq, but clearly the bottom line of this is a decisive American strategic defeat, given America's own definition of its national interest in the Persian Gulf. It was a classically, a classic in fault. Omar Khayyam, the great Parsi poet, wrote long ago, "The thing about history is, it's a one-way street. Time's arrow, as philosophers say. Things cannot be undone. It's not like taking a math test where you're writing in pencil and you think the answer's wrong, you can erase it. You can't do this. History is written in indelible ink. You can't erase it. We cannot undo any of the folly that we committed starting in 2001, in the 1990s, in the 1980s, in the 1970s, in the 1960s, in the 1950s. We can't undo any of this. No more can Iraqis undo their very difficult and cruel history. But what we can do is try to understand it. We can try to make some sense of it." Hannah Arendt said, in a different context, "Nothing which was being done, no matter how stupid, no matter how many people know and foretold the consequences, could be undone or prevented." This was true of both Afghanistan and Iraq. It is not like these things that have turned into horrendous messes were unpredicted. Many people predicted very much what actually happened. In Afghanistan, people who had studied the country said, well, the Soviets took casualties of 15,000, the Afghans casualties of 1,000,000, and the Russians lost. What does that tell you? Does this look like this will work out well for you? Maybe not. And every single Middle East specialist that I know and respect on the eve of the American invasion of Iraq said, don't do it. This is crazy. It's not in the American national interest. It will destabilize the region even further. It makes no sense. Many, many people will lose their lives. This is crazy. Don't do it. And of course, we did it anyway. How to think about this? How are we going to think about this? We've got to back up, and we now have all the necessary analytical tools we need to understand just why things went so wrong in Iraq. First, this simple core idea. We're going to see that Iraq is a state which, as a state, was formed by outsiders. And it put together groups of people who did not get along very well and had not, in many cases, gotten along for a long time, but that hadn't mattered so much before the Great Transformation. That hadn't mattered so much when most people lived in isolated rural areas. Central governments weren't very strong. Modes of communication made it difficult, transportation made it difficult for central states to reach up into remote areas. But once all that begins to change, and once you get the infusion of oil money strengthening a state, you get the infusion of nationalism, of different kinds of nationalism, and then you have the international context of a strategic location and everybody competing, you have a recipe for a serious mess. So we need to go back to basics. Always, always analyze everything in politics in terms of these two pieces, interests and ideology. The state has long been the locus of political struggle in Iraq. This is very much unlike Afghanistan, where the state was always weak, and the state in Iraq was never weak from its beginning as an independent state, because from its beginning as an independent state, it was backed by the Royal Air Force of the United Kingdom. You have major violence power on the side of the state from the beginning. You throw in oil rents. We have a contest, a struggle for the state. And then we have this process of the formation of a state in a society that's very fragmented. So the society is fragmented in a way very not too different from Afghanistan, perhaps somewhat less so, but still. But the big difference is this is a state that is much stronger. So it tries to get people to do what whoever is in charge of the state at the moment thinks. And you know the process of the formation of a modern state has always and everywhere been violent, and it's going to be extremely violent in the case of Iraq. It is not exactly the case, as we will see, that Saddam Hussein, vicious thug though he surely was, invented the violent Iraqi state, any more than is the case that we invented the violence of the Iraqi state. This has deep structural roots. Another thing to remember is that society makes the state, but the state also makes society. State actions shape the way society evolves, just as the nature of the society shapes the way the state evolves. And ideology, the stories that people tell about this state, about what's legitimate, about what the basis of governance ought to be, have always been critical. And we will have to look at a whole series of contending ideologies. Arab nationalism, what kind of Arab nationalism? Kurdish nationalism, communism, Marxism, Islamism, who's Islamism? All these ideologies competing and fighting with each other. Three keys to thinking about the Iraqi state. Patrimonialism, fancy sociological word. It basically means patron-client relations. Big guy, little guy. Little guy gives services, big guy gets aid. Hey, little guy does what the big guy says. Can you do me a service? Think the Godfather one. Okay? Classic kind of case. Many societies are organized like this. An Iraqi society before the arrival of the British was so organized, it has remained a critical feature of Iraqi society ever since. But then we throw in the political economy of oil. This is a huge deal in Iraq. And last, violence. All three working together. This is a skeleton, if you like, an x-ray of state power in Iraq. This has been true from the beginning, okay, of oil money. You have patrimonialism, you have violence. The oil money gives the state the ability to inflict violence. It also gives it money that it can use to support its friends and deny that support to its enemies. And all this highly centralizing process in state formation goes along with a society where nobody agrees on the fundamental basis of legitimacy. We can see this illustrated in flags. All these flags represent different ideologies of what the state in Iraq ought to look like. First flag. This was the flag of the Hashemite kings. Remember, the Hashemites came from the Hejaz in Arabia. They were kicked out by Ibn Saud, the founder of Saudi Arabia. And one of them became the king of Iraq, courtesy of the British. And this remained the flag of Iraq until the king was killed and his body dragged to the streets in Baghdad in 1958. So then a new guy came in, new flag. It has a Kurdish sun on it. He was part Kurdish. And it has the colors, red, white, green, black, of Arab nationalism. Kind of a blended ideology. Didn't work out so well. He too was killed. And then you get the flag of the Ba'ath, of the people who ultimately become Saddam Hussein. And that's the straight up Arab nationalist flag. The flag of Egypt had looked very similar under Gamal Abdel Nasser, changed slightly to this basic structure.
And then along came Desert Storm, and Saddam was desperate, and so he wanted to shore up Islamic support. So he added the phrase, Allahu Akbar, God is most great, to the flag in his own handwriting. Different basis of legitimacy being sought. And then in come the Americans. And then some genius in the American government proposes a flag that looks like this, with a blue symbol on a white background, very similar to the Israeli flag. This was, to put it mildly, noticed by Arabs in Iraq. They didn't like this. This is just typical of what the so-called Coalition Provisional Authority did initially. Really a collection of egregious incompetence worthy of Lord Elphinstone, as we see. And then what we get is the current flag of Iraq, which has retained the phrase Allahu Akbar, and that's for a very good reason, because as we will see, Islamists control the government of Iraq. Or rather, Islamists control the government of Iraq in the Arab region. Because this is the Kurdish flag. As we'll see, Kurds have long wanted to be independent. Their striving for independence destabilized the Iraqi state from the very beginning. And although they'd like an independent state, they're smart enough to realize that given the regional neighborhood and climate, this would not be feasible. But they still have their own flag. To this day, they typically refuse to fly this flag. And then last but not least, there's a small group of Turkmens. They speak a variety of Turkish. They have their own flag that looks very much like the Turkish flag. They encourage fighting quite a bit. And so as you can see, a society where people don't agree about flags is a society where people don't agree about the basis of governance. Another thing to think about. From the very beginning in Iraq, the state until 2003 has been dominated by Sunnis. As we will see, George Bush, in his brilliance, overturned 500 years of history in Iraq. Sunnis have dominated the state in Iraq, whatever that state was, for 500 years until we overthrew it. And from the beginning, this has been resisted. We should say the state was also dominated increasingly starting after the British Mandate, not only by Sunnis, but by Sunni Arabs. Most Kurds are Sunni Muslims. There are some Shia Kurds. But these communities resisted. The state always, like any other state, has a Janus face. It looks internally, trying to get this monopoly on power, trying to reward friends and punish enemies, trying to establish legitimacy, and at the same time has to worry about defending its borders and problems with rivals in the area. And the state is also a locus of struggle over a lot of money. When you put all this together, there is a dynamic, just like there was in Afghanistan, remember that? The way in which, okay, it's a landlocked Arab society, not much agricultural surplus, people living in isolated areas, not too much trade, therefore, very weak state, no revenue, lots of local power wielders, but then throw in outside intervention, big mess. In Iraq, you get sharp struggles to dominate the state, and we will see sharp as an understatement. These are violent, very violent. There are protracted periods of instability in Iraq, as we can see. When Iraq has not been unstable, it has been because of a violently repressive state. That, so far, has tended to be the pattern. But then this state is undermined, either from outside or from inside, and then the cycle repeats itself. Again, very similar to the case of Afghanistan, but with a lot of important differences. And the huge difference is the difference in the nature of the state, how strong and centralized the state is. The state exists because of external powers. The borders of Iraq exist because and only because of decisions taken in the aftermath of World War I. Foreign actions have therefore and remain always key to local circumstances. This, again, is a bit like the case of Afghanistan. But the combination now of oil, not only do we have outsiders setting up and supporting their friends, but now we also have oil rents. These things together create a state
that has been detached from the local society. If you control the Iraqi state, you can do pretty much anything you want. You don't have to worry so much about local resistance because you can simply kill them, which is basically what has happened in Iraqi history. So, different from Afghanistan, key difference is this power of the state until we came along and destroyed this savagely repressive state. And remember, we're good at this. Always remember Boris Yeltsin. You can make a throne of bayonets, but you cannot sit on it. We could get rid of the Iraqi state, and we were entirely incapable of putting anything at all in its place. As we will see, events on the ground would lead in a certain direction, entirely predictable and predicted at the time, namely the triumph of the Shi'i Islamists. No question this was going to happen. It was drop-dead obvious. Many people said it. Many people were ignored. And this, then, leads to locals and outsiders remake the state, Shi'i Islamists, along with the Kurds trying to maintain their own autonomy, hope with an eye, they hope, towards independence in the future. So once again, as the Firesign Theater once said in San Francisco, everything you know is wrong. All the stuff that we're told about Iraq by the American media is profoundly and dangerously ahistorical. It does not recognize the deep fundamental features of these societies. It ignores the processes of social formation and state formation. No wonder it's a big mess. Okay, I'll stop there, and the papers are due here. Thank you very much.
Have a good evening. Democracy, he's fighting for the Reds. He says it's for the peace of all. He's the one who must decide who's to live and who's to die. And he never sees the writing on the wall. But without him, how would Hitler have condemned him at Dachau? Without him, Caesar would have stood alone. He's the one who gives his body as a weapon of the war. And without him, all